Welcome to the May 1st edition of the Engineers and Architects of Hawaii. I'm Michael Albright, the president, and I know we have a small and intimate group, but thought we'd run the meeting like normal anyway. Hope you've all had good weeks and stuff. I was out last week. I was at Montreal. My wife was at a conference up there. And we're lucky to have all this greenery year-round here because up there, nothing has buttered out yet. It still looks like winter. We did have a real warm day when this warm current, I guess, came up through the south and stuff, and it got up almost to 80, which was surprising. But the other days were more like, 45 with rain. Anyway, one thing I'd like to announce here, Bill Warren gave me a letter that we received from one of the recipients of our prize in the engineering fair, and it's a nice letter. I'll just read it quickly. My name is Jennifer Jones, and I was recently awarded in the 55th Honolulu Science and Engineering Fair for project number 715. I wanted to express and thank you to your organization for the $75 savings bond that I received. The science fair was an exciting event for me, and I was very proud to have been selected to compete at the state level and to have my project selected for first place. It was a moment I will always cherish. I know that the many awards presented on April 8th at the ceremony would not have been possible without the outstanding and charitable contributions of our sponsors, and I wanted to thank you again for your generous support of this event. Signed, Jennifer L. Jones.
She's 12 years old.
Well, with that, I would like to have our speaker pick a ticket, if you wouldn't mind, for our game of chance here.
It's
477-973. Hey! What shall we do with this? to the fun. To the fun. Okay. And I think that probably brings us to our program chair this month, who also happens to be our speaker today. So I've asked Sam if he would give a brief introduction to start with.
I think I've introduced Geoffrey a couple times before, so I'm probably going to say exactly the same thing, because I don't know anything new about him. But he's arrived here in Honolulu in the 50s, even worked with Henry Kaiser out in Hawaii Kai, I think, on some of the development on East Hawaii. And in particular, he worked on the biggest McDonald's, I think, at the time, which was built in Aina Haina. And he was also, I've also told you that he was instrumental on passing the building codes around the Diamond Head so that the high-rises didn't encroach too much on the Diamond Head. And Art, can you say anything more about what you know about Art?
Jeffrey's been involved with M.J. Sullivan, Maurice Sullivan, and he's done many wonderful projects for him very conscientiously, and he's thoroughly involved in our AIA Honolulu chapter and has been for some time. I think that covers it in a nutshell.
With that, we'll let Geoffrey talk about his... I said 52 years, it might be more, it might be less.
It might be more, it might be less, yes. I wish it was less. Anyway, what I will do is I will just give you a little brief bio of sort of coming up to when I came to Hawaii, and then when we get to that, we'll sort of go through some of these projects, and I've just got some little pictures here that we'll probably pass out and just, pass around. It's not nearly as professional as we usually have, but it's informal for a very small group. Anyway, well, I like Ralph. I started off as a Brit. Are you still a Brit, Ralph?
Or are you American citizen?
Well, me too. Yeah. I used to do a lot of work for the Navy, and I couldn't do that unless I was a citizen. So I am an American citizen now. But anyway, well, I was born in England in 1928, which you can that makes me 81. Don't feel it. And lived in England until 1940. And 1940, I lived in the Isle of Wight, and we used to get bombed every night. And I had an uncle, a great uncle, in Vancouver, who said to my parents, "Send the boys." So we were to become evacuees. It was pretty exciting for us. We didn't really realize the danger. And so this little town in the Isle of Wight, 70 people killed one night because the bombers, when they went to Portsmouth and Southampton, they dropped bombs on cars on the way back. So we went up to London, and we were told, oh, you won't get bombed tonight because we have these barrage balloons. And the barrage balloons will save London from bombing. Well, of course, you know, several weeks later, London was in flames. Then we went up to Liverpool, and we got on the ship, the Duchess of Richmond, and we sailed with another liner, the Arandora Star, and we had an escort around the north of Ireland, and then it left us, and the next morning, the Arandora Star was sunk, and I remember the people saying, well, aren't we going to pick up survivors? It was a very, one of the saddest stories of the war. It was the first shipment of German and Italian internees being sent out to Canada, and most of them were waiters or chefs or people who really had nothing to do with Nazi Germany, but they were all on the ship, the Arandora Star, and it was a beautiful cruise ship before the war. It had sailed absolutely around the world, and the captain, Captain Moulton, who had been on it since it was built in 1927, went down with the ship. It was pretty sad. It turned out afterwards that Günther Prien, who sank the Arandora Star, was a big hero in Germany because he'd been into Scapa Flow and sank the Royal Oak, a British battleship, which was like Britain's Pearl Harbor. And it turned out he only had one torpedo left, and he had two ocean liners, Duchess of Richmond with children, Arandora Star with his people, and took up and out. And then afterwards, a few months later, the city of Benares, they were still sending children to Canada, and it was sunk, and nearly all the children died. And then Churchill said, hey, that's it, no more. Anyway, that's a different story, nothing to do with architecture. So then, but once I'd been in Canada, though, I tasted all these good things like Coca-Cola and Jack Benny, and so when I went back to England, I thought, gee, I've got to get back over there one of these days. So I went back to England, and I was 16 then. We went back in a convoy because the war was still on. It was, I think it was July 1944. This was on the Glen Strae. The Glen Strae, we kept getting engine trouble, and we'd break down, and we used to sing a song, you'll never get to heaven on the old Glen Strae, because the old Glen Strae don't go that way. But we did get to Liverpool, and then I went to a school at King's Worcester, which is a school that was actually founded by Henry VIII. A nice cathedral city, Worcester. You know Worcester, Ralph. Right on the Severn there, which floods every now and again, and we can't play cricket because it floods. Then after that, then I had to do my time in the Navy, because the conscription was still on. So I went in the Royal Navy as an air fisherman's mate, and I was assigned to the sloop, the Rochester, and I don't think I was cut out to be an electrician. I used to plunge the ship in darkness quite often. The worst time was when the captain was in his bath. Paterson, what have you done now? You know. So anyway, so that wasn't it. So then I wanted to really be a journalist. I wanted to be in Fleet Street, drinking in the pubs and covering the trials of the Old Bailey, and that's what I really wanted. And Mother said, oh, that's not a very honorable profession. And she said, why don't you try architecture? So anyway, so I sort of backed into it and went to Oxford. It was a school called the Oxford School of Architecture. I was there for 4 years, 5 years, and I liked Oxford so much that I stayed on. And I thought, well, this is great. And in England, the pubs are all owned by these big companies. You remember Eyncroup and Allsop and Watney's? Well, Eyncroup and Allsop had an office in Oxford. And I thought, well, that's great. I can design the pubs on all these places where I got bombed. Well, that didn't quite work out. I was assigned to the old pubs. And I remember driving maybe out to Ludlow, and the landlord of the pub, he'd have two ambitions. And one would be to get a new fireplace, and the other would be to get me drunk so he could get it. But I had the book that showed that he had a new fireplace back in 1872. and he wasn't due yet. So then I would drive back to Oxford, forgetting all the dimensions, and thinking, I just don't think there's too much future in this. Although I got 40% off of my liquor, which was very nice. I used to drink a lot of beer in those days. And then a miracle happened in December of 1955 at Christmas. A friend of mine, Dennis Page, who'd been a year ahead of me at Oxford, came back and we met, and he was actually working in Philadelphia. He said, I can get you a job in Philadelphia. But, I mean, things that happen at a party, you never know. And so I said, well, great, that'll at least get me across the duck pond, and later on we can think about Vancouver. But so I was sent a green card and a ticket on the old Super G Constellation. Do you remember that? That was before the Jets. So I arrived in Philadelphia and worked for a firm called Belanti and Klaus. Now, Belanti and Klaus, at that time, they were doing a children's reception center, you know, for children from broken homes and things like that. And it was all designed to make the children happy, you know. And so Seppo Klaus, who was German and spoke with a very German accent, he had this project for me. He took me up to the roof and he said, I want you to lay out drains for the children, of course. So anyway, and then he said, I'm going away for a week, but I'll be back in about a week. So I spent a week laying out this wonderful train. I had stations, and I had shunting yards, and I had all these things. And Seppo came back about a week later, and he looked at my plans, and he said, well, what is this? What is this? I said, well, these are the trains that you wanted. He said, I didn't mean trains. He said, I meant roof trains. He meant roof drains. So anyway, I didn't get fired, and but I think everybody else at the office knew, you know, and they would always play tricks on me. I mean, one day I'd go down to the office and there'd be nobody in the office, and I wonder why nobody's there, and it would be Washington's birthday, and I figured, well, as a limey, I wouldn't be interested in Washington's birthday. Anyway, so after 4 years in Philadelphia, working mostly on schools, I decided to go to Phoenix, Arizona. It wasn't quite, you know, in a direction of Vancouver, but it was sort of on its way. And, you know, when you go to a new town, people always tell you people to look up so-and-so. So I go up to Phoenix, and somebody said, you're the second Englishman I've met today. I said, oh, really? Who's the other one? Oh, Desmond Muirhead. So I don't know if you remember Desmond Muirhead, but he... Then we got together, and he said, no, don't stop in Phoenix. Come to Hawaii. And I said, no, I've got to wait for my wagon train to come in from Philadelphia because, you know, it wasn't here yet. But a year later, he did persuade me. And so now we're getting to Hawaii finally. Oh, so in 1961, I came to Hawaii. But it was, I guess, two years after statehood. And our first project was with Henry Kaiser. Desmond had come barreling in here, and in spite of all the local firms and everything, they wanted that contract. He was a big talker, and he talked Henry into designing Hawaii Kai. So we used to meet with Henry Kaiser about two or three times a week, and he was a tough bird, he really was. If we had a good meeting, we'd go to the Halekulani for Mai Tais, and if we had a bad meeting, we'd go Casey Drive-In. Well, that summer, I ate at Casey Drive-In quite a bit. But in a way, it worked out very well, because later on, I teamed up with Maurice Sullivan at McDonald's. And I used to moonlight houses, and when Desmond left, Desmond then kind of got tired of Hawaii and took off, and actually became a very very well-known golf course architect. He designed golf courses all around the world. He did the one, that's the one in California, Dinosaur. He was very close to Dinosaur, and he designed that golf course. And then he was known really as the Salvador Dali of golf course design. He had one where they had different people, and he would name the different holes, and there was the Marilyn Monroe hole where he had the two mounds right next to the green, and he found it outrageous that they wouldn't let him put the nipples on the mound. So anyway, so he was gone, and then I worked for that. Well, then I went to Jack Warnecke, the Warnecke office, when we were doing the state capitol, and those were really wild days. Jack Warnecke was quite a character, and of course he designed the grave for JFK, and he was the first lover, really, the first lover that Jackie had up there after JFK died, and they would be here in Hawaii, and officially he'd be staying at Diamond Head and she'd be at the Kaiser estate. But they would go off to Kauai, and I was the office manager there, and we had to babysit young John and Carolyn and teach them to draw. I wish I had those drawings now. Anyway, and then I used to moonlight buildings. In fact, mostly houses. There was nothing much in Hawaii Kai at that time, but I teamed up with this chap who was a developer and did the first houses there in the triangle there in Hawaii Kai. They were built, I think, for $35,000. And then somebody called me about the Wade House, and I thought, well, I better not moonlight anymore. So I left Warnecke, and now we're finally getting to the pictures. The Wade House was the first house that I did, and we can just maybe pass these around, perhaps. Any of you who play golf, you probably know it's out on the ocean at the Wildlife Golf Course, and it always shows up very well on the Sony Open. John Wade, at that time, was involved with almost everything you read in Hawaii. He owned the Honolulu bookshops. He owned Hawaii magazine distributors. He had everything at the university. And sometimes we call it the house that pornography built. But anyway, he was really quite a character. And as the third architect, actually, one died, and the other one, I'm not sure what happened to. Oh, Lou Ingelson was the second architect on it, but they didn't quite get along with that. So then from that house, all of a sudden, Maurice Sullivan comes on the scene, and he has this piece of property out in Ainahaina. He wants a house, so that would be the next house that I did. That's a big house too, and an interesting story that too. In 1975, there was a full page in the Sunday Advertiser and Star Bulletin, and it was called Mansions from the Sky. And it had Doris Duke's house, and it had Admiral's quarters, Kaiser Estate, and then these two houses. And on Monday, both of them called me up and were furious. I didn't have my name in the article. I didn't know the article was going to be written because, they kept very private on it all. But they were furious because why are the people that provide all the food and all the reading material to us in Hawaii at these high prices, why are they building these big houses? Anyway, so that didn't sit too well. But so I've got one or two more houses. One of my favorite houses is one I did in Kahulu. Ed Stevens was a very good friend of mine, and he was very active in the Sierra Club, and he was, I don't know if you knew Ed, Ed was a super person, and he had a lot out in Kahulu with a lovely view of Kaneohe, so I did his house, and that was very sad because he only lived in it for, not too long, and died of cancer, and we scattered his ashes at the house. Actually, this shows probably all the different styles, because a lot of architects are known for a certain style, whereas mine has always been whatever the clients, and some clients don't have very good sense of style, but we do what we can for them. Well, now we're back again to Sullivan, perhaps. McDonald's at that time, this was 1968 when we did the house, and so we met. Ray Kroc came out, and we drove around the island looking for sites. And the first McDonald's actually was in Ainahaina in 1968. Most of them have been torn down now, but I think they're going to tear down Ainahaina, which is a shame in a way, because we tried to break the mold from what was just this sloping roof and this huge arches.
The one up between East Pine Drive?
Yeah, that's it. Yeah, with a little roof and with a chimney. And, yeah. I thought you could have put, an exhaust with a chimney and, and you can put Santa Claus on at Christmas time, you know. So.
It was the first one in my life.
It was? Yeah, 1968. Yes, yes.
Is that a heritage?
I don't think. No, I think they're going to tear it down. They've torn down most of them. They've torn down quite a few. Palolo, the one in Palolo, was torn down. The original Caldor was torn down. Quite a few torn down. Yeah. So, and then Sally, of course, at the Anaheim office building, which is sort of an interesting building that's still there, that long gray building. That was interesting because it was residential zoning, so we could only go 25 feet high. So somehow we managed to get underground parking and
the swimming pool.
I was going to mention the swimming pool. You remember that? Yes. Yeah. Anyway, that's still there. Are we still going on this? All right. And then after doing about 30 McDonald's, then I started doing Burger King with John Finney, and we did a few Burger Kings. This is the Burger King in Kapahulu, which again has been torn down because that's where Safeway is now. So probably in a few more years, I don't think any of my buildings will probably survive, This was a McDonald's. Do you remember, this is the McDonald's on 4th Street Mall. I can't remember the name of it. There was a clothing shop there for many years. And that's been there for a while. Yeah, this was my own house on Weinberg that I lived in for many years, which has a nice view of the golf course. You see, when I do my own house, you can see it's quite contemporary as opposed to the rather traditional ones. Well, one of the most disappointing projects that I did was for Turtle Bay, a clubhouse. It was owned then by a Japanese company called Asahi Juken, and they had the property, and at that time Arnold Palmer was involved with the new golf course out there, and we worked on this project for about a year, and we had it designed right down to really the last ashtray, and we had all the building permits approved and everything, and they went bankrupt. So this is probably my most frustrating project because it really never got built. And the design, there was an old Haleiwa Hotel, which was actually designed by the same architect as the Moana Hotel. And so basically most of our detailing was very similar to that, and that was really very disappointing.
Designing the Foodland store.
Foodland store, yes. I did the one, I did several. I did the one in, I did several Maui, mostly Outer Island ones, but I did do the one in on School Street. I did the school and remodeled quite a lot of them. And for Sullivan, I mean, I could write a book about Maurice Sullivan. I mean, he was really the most outstanding person you could ever meet. He was like a father to me in a way. And even after I wasn't doing any work with him, as he was getting older, we would still just have a little private lunch once a month at the Pacific Club. And the people would always come over. But he was a bit of a chameleon in a way. One of my favorite stories is, and I think it was in the School Street Foodland, and he was blasting me for something. I think it was probably a column in the wrong place, And this lady came up, and she said, "Oh, Mr. Sullivan, can you show me where the marmalade is?" And he puts his arm around her, and he takes her over there, and he gets the marmalade, and then hugs her and everything, and says, "Oh, now is there anything else I could do for you?" And off she goes, and he comes up. Now, what the fuck were we talking about? but my favorite story with Sully is he called me up one day, and he said, "Oh, I'm going to meet Harry Weinberg today, and I want you to come with me and meet Harry Weinberg." I said, "Well, I suppose so, okay." And he said, "Now he's the richest man in Honolulu, so I want you to dress nicely and wash up the carpet and everything like that." So I pick him up and I would drive over there. Of course, it's on Nimitz Highway, and you step in onto this concrete floor that has a little water on it, and then you look where Harry is, and Harry, behind his desk, he has a big trestle table with lumps on it and a sheet over it, and those are all the leases, you know. So anyway, so when we get there, Harry says, "Oh, Sully, things are bad," and they spend about 10 minutes crying about, you know, how bad. I mean, these are two rich men, how bad everything is, you know, and they're just, you know, crying on each other's shoulder. And then finally, Harry says, "Okay, Sully, what are you here for?" And Sully says, "Well," putting on his nice gesture, he said, "Harry, I was thinking of you know, this Rotary Foundation." And, "Well, what's that? What's that? Well, Rotary Foundation. Harry, I was thinking maybe $15,000?
$15,000?
Anyway, they haggle away for quite a while, and eventually they settle on $12,000. So everybody's happy. I go back to my office, and Sully calls me and says, "I think Harry liked you. Would you call him and try and get him back up to $15,000? I said, "Sully, I'm your architect. I'm not your fundraiser, you know. But he did wonderful things. And I must say, with Harry, since he died, what he's really done, I used to have 10 people. I let them all go. And since then, I've done these projects, and I haven't even photographed them. But I did the new Boys and Girls Club out in Ever Beach, that was Harry Weinberg. And the things that, you know, that he's really done. But when he was alive, I always remember he used to eat every day at the Tahitian Lanai, and I'd go there sometimes, and if he saw me, he'd call me over and he'd say, "How many McDonald's does Sully have now?" I mean, which was really something. And so that's about it. Let's see. The last one here for the pictures. We used to do a lot of work with Dave Stringer. He would do the preliminary design, and then we would do the construction and the drawings. And the one that I'm so proud of that came up pretty nicely was the Kapalua Clubhouse on Maui. So I've got some pictures of that there. But the other one that quite involved with was the, are you familiar with the Aloha Care Center in Windward City? It's a 120-bed home. That was a sort of a sad story, because the person that brought me into that was Ed Kellett. Does anybody remember Ed Kellett? He was quite well known, and he was at the groundbreaking and everything, and really brought me into it, but he died of cancer just shortly after. So that's about the only project where I really, because his son took over, Eberson, and that's the only project that I really did that with the pretty intensive construction management on that one, and that's that one right there. This was Office Building 1. Yeah, this we did at Hawaii again with David Stringer. We did a lot of the office buildings out there. That was that office building, and that pretty well wraps it up. Any questions? Yes.
Did you ever get a client that started to redesign your architecture, and how did you
see that? Well, I had some very difficult clients. The most difficult client I really had was John Wade on the Wildlife Golf Course house. I mean, he was a really, I mean, Henry Kaiser was a saint compared with him, and he would call me in the middle of the night. And I remember he called me once, it was about 2 in the morning, and he said, "You made a big mistake on the house." I said, "Well, what mistake was that?" He said, "Well, do you know what sort of lease rent I'm paying?" I mean, I didn't know. But what I'd done was, I'd set the house back 5 feet, and then I had the gates and the wall there. So basically, I'd taken away 5 feet of his lot. And then I made the big mistake. I said, "Well, John, it's always been in the plans." And he said, "Well, if I could read plans, I would have designed a fucking house myself." So, you know, you get quite a few of those. I had a very difficult client too in Lanikai recently too, that I did a big remodel for, and John Sutton was the contractor on that, and that was a very difficult project. We had a sort of falling out, but I bumped into the other day at Bocce, and I think we're friends again. So, Any other questions?
What building codes influence their design as far as architectural concepts?
Well, I try to follow them. You know, I try to follow the whatever the current building code is. You know, it is. You know, it's very important. You know, to follow the code. And I do have to say too that. Touch wood, I'm really rather proud of the fact that I practiced for all these years and did not have any lawsuit. I did come close very once. I came very close with McDonald's. There was a lady who came out of McDonald's. She came out of the restroom. And she fell over the step, and she got rather injured. So I went through the deposition and everything, and her lawyer, you know, was quite difficult, you know. But I said, well, you know, if the careless person, she was careless, because thousands of people were coming in and out of that toilet, and she must have seen the step when she went into the toilet. And her lawyer said, Mr. Paterson, she was 7 months pregnant. And I said, are you going to blame me for that too? And they threw out the case. Do you have a question?
I had a question. You know, this is an Engineers and Architects of Hawaii Association.
Right.
And I was wondering if you could just tell us a few humorous things about some of your relationship with engineering consultants.
My favorite saying is that, you know, if an architect, you know, designs a house without an engineer, it'll probably fall down. But if the engineer builds a house without an architect, it should be torn down. Sorry about that. We're outnumbered here. Let's get out of here.
Well, you know, Frank Lloyd Wright would design it. It's kind of impossible, like the boiling water thing.
Oh, yes.
Could never survive.
Yeah, I know.
But yet, he said,
yeah,
he stuck to his guns.
All his houses leaked. Yeah. And there was one chap that was very upset because it was right over his favorite chair. And Frank Lloyd Wright said, move the chair. I think we're pretty well on time.
Yes, all right.
Well, Geoffrey, thank you very much for your talk. This has been lovely. And I think you're absolutely right about the relationship with engineers and architects. We really need a synergy between us. Neither one of us can do it alone.
Exactly.
And it's good that it's like that. We have a certificate of appreciation for you. You may be getting a collection of them by now, but...
I just spelled Paterson right with one T. I love it. Yeah.
We'll have to thank Sam for that.
All right.
In any case, thank you very much, and if there's nothing else to come before us, I'll adjourn the meeting. We'll see you next week.